You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon and welcome to Gardens of California. My name is Gerald Turney and I'm your host and instructor. This is a live garden show broadcast. We talk about everything from trees to turf and apples to zinnias. Our phone number is 800-339-1193. If you haven't watched the show before, I'm a botanist and a plant pathologist and an arborist. I also have a California Agricultural Pest Control Advisors license. So I've been working in the landscape industry for a long time and working with gardens and garden plants and trees and all that kind of stuff. So today we're actually going to talk about aloes and agaves. That'll be our lecture today. But we always start the show off with upcoming events. If you are a student in the class, you need to go to an outside event and write an essay. About that, about what you learned at the event. And hopefully you'll go out and learn something about a new plant group or a genus or a plant family or maybe how to water, how to fertilize, how to prune, all those kind of interesting topics that a lot of homeowners are woefully not educated in. So let's take a look at our upcoming events, and you can put one of these on your calendar. We have Frank McDonough's plant information session on October 1st from 1:30 to 3. This is also for his volunteers at the Arboretum, but anyone can attend. He'll talk about some of the latest issues facing the Los Angeles County Arboretum and other issues that may face your garden as well. In addition to that, we have the Garden Talks with Lily Singer. This is October 9th from 9:30 to 12:30. Lily is a very well-known and well-respected horticulturalist in Southern California and organizes this series of lectures at the Los Angeles County Arboretum, bringing in guest speakers who speak on a variety of topics. So always a lot to learn when you are working with Lily or any of her invited speakers. In addition to that, we have All About Trees. This will be at the South Coast Botanic Gardens down in Palos Verdes Peninsula. And you can learn about our tree diversity in our urban forest in Southern California. We have one of the highest diversity of trees grown as ornamentals from anywhere in the world. We have a unique environment where we can grow trees from all over the world, and we do. So that would be very educational for anybody who wants to learn more about trees. And let's see if we have another event. Les Aristes de Flores Flower. You can see more than 40 nature-inspired arrangements and miniatures at the Los Angeles County Arboretum on November 2nd from 10 to 3. So that should be a lot of fun, and you'll be able to get out and enjoy the Los Angeles County Arboretum. Okay, that's our last upcoming event. I just want to digress briefly before we go into our lecture. Of course, I want to remind our viewers that we are live, and you can call in with questions or email in questions. About your garden, if you're having a problem in your garden, our number is 800-339-1193. You can also email in your questions. Last week we had a lot of people emailing and calling in. So just send us an email to askdhtvlive@gmail.com. And if you have a photograph of your garden, you can attach it to the email. We can bring it up and take a look at it. The wonders of modern technology. I can actually look at a problem tree you might have in your garden. You might want to know how to prune it or how big it's going to get or how to water it. You know, let us know and I'll be glad to answer your questions. But I wanted to just mention for outside events and for anybody who enjoys getting out and enjoying gardens, enjoying our wonderful Southern California weather. And it's a wonderful day today. It actually rained at my house this morning briefly. So it, you know, gives you that fresh air smell after rain. But we have some of the really great, some of the greatest botanical gardens you could find anywhere in the world here in Southern California. We've got Descanso Gardens, we've got the Huntington Botanical Gardens, we've got the Los Angeles County Arboretum, we have Rancho Santa Ana out in Claremont, we've got the Fullerton, we've got the San Diego Botanic Garden. So we have all these wonderful botanic gardens. They have classes, they have beautiful collections. You can visit them multiple times throughout the year to see their collections blooming or putting on the color that they might provide, a seasonal color, depending on the time of the year you visit. So I encourage you to go out and visit our botanical gardens and see what they're doing in their gardens. Particularly the Huntington Botanical Gardens has a 10-acre desert collection. So a lot of people now are very interested in switching over their landscapes from mostly a large area of turf to a low water garden. And the best way to do that is with succulents, cacti, and we're going to talk about aloes and agaves today, which can be the real backbone of a low water use garden. They require very little water. You might water them once a month in the spring. You could let them go dry all summer if you wanted. In years when we have a little more water available, we've had good winter rains and the state's not in a drought situation, you can water them every couple weeks in the summer to keep them fresh and doing quite well. But you don't really need to water them if you're just trying to keep them alive and hold on until we get some more rain. So if you visit the Huntington Botanical Gardens, you take a look at their desert collection. The Los Angeles County Arboretum also has an excellent collection of South African materials, and they've got a lot of Madagascar materials too. Now, the caveat is that a lot of these materials are tender and they'll freeze. And so you have to be very careful that you're selecting plants that are appropriate for where you live in Southern California or California in general. So if you're up at maybe in Altadena or Sierra Madre or even up at Big Bear, up in the mountains, you'd have to be very careful to select plants that are tolerant to freezing temperatures or cold weather. Whereas if you're down in West LA or along the coast, Santa Monica, you're rarely going to experience hard freezes, and you'll be able to grow a lot of materials that are tender. That term tender means that they freeze or get cold damage at relatively higher temperatures than something that would be cold tolerant. So often plants will experience damage in somewhere in the 30s or certainly below 32 degrees at freezing, whereas other plants can easily tolerate temperatures as low as 10 or even zero. So you know, pick your plants carefully, especially when you're dealing with aloes and agaves. So let's go on and get right into it. Oh, one last thing. I do have a mystery object today. Sometimes I bring in a mystery plant. Now, I used to have bigger ones of these, but my bigger ones are on display at the Los Angeles County Fair as part of the exhibit for the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner Weights and Measures Department, of which I am an employee. I'm the plant pathologist for the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner Department of Weights and Measures, and I run a plant diagnostic clinic. What I have in my hand here is a little piece of a pine branch and this unusual growth on the branch. And if you know what that is or want to take a guess what this is, give me a call and take a guess. It's rather interesting, but I have some bigger ones. This is more typical of the size you see on pines. Now, if you've got a pine and you see these on the branches, call in and I'll tell you what it is. So we'll keep this sitting right here. You can call in if you get an idea what that is or just want to know. Take a wild guess. So let's talk about agaves. And we can bring up our first picture of an agave behind me, so you'll know what an agave looks like. Now, the reason I've put agaves and aloes together is because they look very similar, but there are some very important differences in their fundamental characteristics and how they perform in the landscape, what they're going to do in the landscape. So let's talk about agaves. Of course, they are monocots. Now, monocots are plants that when the seed grows, it comes up and it has one leaf, as opposed to dicots or dicotyledons. It's an abbreviation. They're dicotyledons or monocotyledons. And the cotyledon is the first leaf from a seed. And so monocots, things like corn is a monocot. Grasses are monocots. So agaves are monocots. They have some characteristics that are uniform among monocots. They have parallel venation. You know, all the veins in the leaf run in the same direction. They are not. They don't have netted venation. That's what dicotyledons or dicots have. So they are perennial. They grow for many years. But almost all agaves are what we call monocarpic, which means that the plant flowers and then the plant dies. Now, they grow, their growth form is referred to as a rosette, which means all the leaves are in a whorl around a stem. Often you can't even see the stem. They are mostly native to Mexico, but they are also native to the southern and western United States and central and tropical South America. They are referred to as succulents, and of course many things are succulent, and that means that the leaves are thick and fleshy and filled with water, or I guess that's the best way to describe a succulent. So there are many, that characteristic, being succulent, is found in many different plant families that are not necessarily genetically related. And, you know, in fact, this is a good point to make, is that when you have similar environments around the world, where you have a desert, deserts in Africa, deserts in the Americas, the plants develop similar characteristics. They evolve to develop similar characteristics to survive in that environment. That doesn't mean they're genetically related. That means that they have actually come to the same adaptation through evolution. So that's why they look the same, but they're actually have quite different flowers. And that's, the flower is really tells you everything. So they're succulents, and almost all agaves have a large rosette. In fact, I think really all agaves will have a rosette form. Thick, fleshy leaves, ending generally in a sharp point with a spiny margin. The stem is usually short or not visible at all, often looking like the leaves are growing right out of the soil. And I mentioned that they're monocarpic, but typically, the rosette will flower and then it will die, but then plants will grow off the base. They'll sucker from the base and you get new rosettes. Now, that's not always true. Some will actually, the whole plant will die, but they'll usually drop a lot of seeds and then they come up all over the place. After development of the fruit, the original plant dies, but suckers frequently produce at the base. Some people think agaves are cactus. They're not cactus, not at all. They're not even really closely related to cactus, and of course they look a lot like aloes too. Now, prior to being reorganized, agaves were believed to have about 166 species. It is now known that this concept was what we call paraphyletic, which means you had related groups next to it. And so they've all been put into agave, and a lot of genera were lumped into agave. And it's believed there are about 208 species of agave. And you could further divide that into subgenera, but we don't want to go into that too much. And so there's a lot of variation in their natural setting where they're native. So you can have really quite different looking plants that are really the same species over a wide range of area. And those are mostly environmentally induced differences. Now, there are quite a few species that I mentioned, probably over 200, but there are a handful that are commonly grown in Southern California. Agave Americana, the century plant, Agave Augustifolia, Agave Tequiliana is used to make tequila, and Agave Attenuata, which is probably kind of a unique agave in terms of its appearance and how it grows. Now what we have behind me is a cultivar called Agave Shark Skin. Let's bring that up full screen. And I photographed this one at the Los Angeles County Arboretum. They have a nice collection there too. Actually, now that I look at that picture, I took this picture at the Huntington Botanical Gardens because this is their label. I know that's their label. And you got some barrel cactus in the back. Now, I'll tell you right off the bat, the difference between agaves and aloes. One of the easiest ways to tell the difference is that agaves end in a very sharp pointed tip that is as sharp and it's hard, very, very sclerotized. So, and it's as sharp as a needle. And if you bump up against this plant, this will go right through your pants and poke a hole in your leg, and it'll hurt. It'll hurt pretty good. The other thing is that agaves have flexible leaves. You can actually bend the leaf and it won't snap. It's not brittle. So those two things really distinguished agaves from aloes in terms of, if you're just looking at a plant, the sharp tip and the flexible leaf is characteristic of agave. Now, let's take a look at the next one again. The next one is a different one. This is agave. Our next agave is agave blue glow. So very similar, but it's a named cultivar, blue glow, a hybrid. And our next one is a species, agave havaradiana. And this one, you can see, is actually in flower. You can't see the flower. Here's the inflorescence right here coming up. So this one, after this blooms, this whole thing will die. Now, it may send up pups at the base. You may get new plants growing off the base, or you may not. So let's talk about this particular species. Medium to large-sized century plant, native to rocky grassland slopes from West Texas to Mexico. So this is one that is native to North America, to the United States, found at elevations of 4,000 to 6,000 feet. So you can expect this would be very cold hardy. Forms 3 to 4 foot wide single rosette and rarely offsetting. So once this flowers and produces its seed, you'll probably lose the plant. Now that could take quite a few years. It may take you 10 years for it to bloom and die. Thick spiny leaves to 20 inches long and 6 inches wide. A very hardy if protected from winter moisture when temperatures fall below 20 degrees. So this is a species you could probably grow fairly easily up against the foothills in the San Gabriel Valley, where you get a little harder freezes, a little colder up in Altadena and Sierra Madre. Mature specimens are topped with stunningly massive 12-foot tall asparagus-looking flower spikes in summer. So when it does bloom, the flower spike will be 12 feet tall, which is quite spectacular. But then it's going to die. Let's take a look at our next agave, which is agave quinquingola. This is a distinctive agave that is native to Cerro Quinquingola, a limestone mountain in the southern Mexican state of Oaxaca. I bring this up full screen, get a good look at it. And now this one doesn't seem quite as, you know, this leaf probably isn't quite as stiff as some of the others. But this is agave guinguinola. It grows on sheer cliff faces in prodigious numbers, resembling dense colonies of sea stars. There is some variation in leaf size and color. Predictably, an offsetting clone that lends itself to propagation has become the most widely distributed form in cultivation. And as it happens, it has light green foliage. And you can buy this from a lot of different nurseries. This one should be fairly easy to obtain. A lot of the species that we may talk about may be kind of difficult to find. You might have to look around, go to some of the succulent society meetings, see if someone's propagating it, some backyard grower is propagating it. Not all nurseries will propagate all plants, and so sometimes when you pick a particular species that you really want to grow in your garden, you have to hunt for it if it's not something that's in wide distribution. So it's being propagated right now by tissue culture. It is actually being propagated by the Huntington Botanical Gardens, and so if you wanted to get this and you went to their plant sale, usually in May of every year, you'll probably be able to get it there. Now our next one is agave desertii, but let's talk about agave americana first, because that's our next picture. And then we'll go back to desertii, because I think I've got my pictures out of order. But let's bring up agave americana and bring this up full screen. Now you can see from this picture that there's a big clump of them. There's a whole bunch of them. That's almost certainly because originally there was one in the middle, came up, flowered with all its flowers, and then rained seed down here, and then all those seeds grew. So that's really, really very typical of agaves. So commonly known as the century plant, or sometimes called American aloe, which is unfortunate because it's not an aloe and it's not in the same family. Originally from Mexico, but cultivated worldwide as an ornamental plant. And for a lot of years, I thought Agave Americana was native to southwestern United States because you see so many. And I learned later it's actually just native to Mexico and is an introduced species here in California. But it does naturalize. Naturalized in many regions, grows wild in Europe, South Africa, India, and Australia. And I might add, it grows wild in vacant lots in Southern California. Misnamed century plant, lives only 10 to 30 years, and that's going to be based mostly on how much you water it. If you water it frequently, or at least regularly, like once a month, spring and summer, maybe even into the fall, it will grow a lot faster if you only water it or don't water it at all. So you only water it a couple times in a year, you don't water it at all, you let it survive on annual rainfall, it's going to grow a lot slower. It has a spreading rosette of gray-green leaves up to 2 meters long. So the leaves themselves can be about 6 to 7 feet in length, each with a spiny margin and a heavy spike at the tip that can pierce to the bone. So when it flowers, the spike has big yellow flowers, may reach up to 8 meters, 26 feet in height. When these bloom, they're absolutely spectacular. Unfortunately, you know when it starts to bloom that you're going to lose your plant. Common name likely derives from its nature of flowering only once at the end of its long life. The plant dies after flowering but produces suckers from the base which continue its growth. Now it may make suckers or it may just seed in a lot of plants around it. It's when you come on a big clump of them, you don't know. Are all these suckers from an original plant or are they all seedlings from seed? This was actually described by Carl Linnaeus in the 1750 edition of Species Plantarum. And it has the same binomial name that was given in 1753. That's quite unusual because generally plant names change quite a bit. There are a lot of different cultivars, and you can see one of those cultivars behind me, Marginata, with yellow stripes along the margins of each leaf. Let's bring that up and take a look at that. So this is really quite colorful. This is, of course, a century plant, Agave Americana, but the cultivar name is Marginata. Now, the next one I want to show you is called Mediopicta, which is our next picture. And this has Mediopicta alba. This has a central white band down the middle. And there is a third one called Mediopicta aurora with a central yellow band. Instead of this being white in here, this would be yellow. Now, unfortunately, those aren't particularly stable genetically. And if you grow from seed, they'll usually just be all green. And I was talking to a nurseryman within the last few months about Agave Americanas and how they get their these variegated forms. And he says the only way they get them is from offsets. When they grow seed, if the mother plant flowers and dies back and they collect all that seed and they plant all the seed, almost all of it is going to come up pure green. It's just going to be Agave Americana, and it's not going to be the cultivated variety that you give these various names to. So now if you'll notice, when it's a cultivated variety or a cultivar, the name is given in single quotes. So it'll say Agave, quote, Mediopicta, alba, quote. So that's how you can tell it's a cultivar or a cultivated variety. So let's take a look at our next picture, which is Agave desertii, and bring that up full screen. And you can see how tall these flower spikes can be. This is really quite tall, probably 15 to 20 feet in height. Here's this big clump of them. I'll tell you a little bit about this one. The desert agave, the century plant or the mezcal plant, agave native to the desert regions in Southern California, Arizona, and Baja California. So this is clearly a native plant to California and native to Southern California, so a real native. Its tall yellow flower stalks do not dot dry rocky slopes and washes throughout the spring. Of course, it has a rosette of fleshy gray-green leaves, 20 to 70 centimeters long, which is going to be about 10 to 35 inches long, and 4.5 to 10 centimeters broad. That's 2 to 5 inches across, sharp spines on the edges and at the tips, flowers at maturity, 20 to 40 years. So the inflorescence can be 2 to 6 meters in height. 6 meters would be about 18 feet in height. The panicle bears numerous yellow, funnel-shaped flowers 3 to 6 centimeters long. There are two varieties of agave desertii. There's variety desertii with numerous rosettes, and this is Southern California only in the wild, and variety simplex, usually with one or only a few rosettes, Southern California and Arizona. So that one is found in both Arizona and California. Let's see. Now, let me just go back and briefly talk again about Agave Americana, because there's a couple of interesting things about it. The flower stem can be cut when flowering, and a sweet liquid will come out called agua mille, or mille. I'm not sure how to pronounce that correctly, or honey water. It gathers in the heart of the plant. This can be fermented to produce a drink called pulque. The leaves also yield fibers known as pita, which are suitable for making rope, matting, coarse cloth, and are used for embroidery of leather in a technique known as piteiro. I don't know, I'm probably not pronouncing that right. Both pulque and magawi fiber were important to the economy of pre-Columbia Mexico. Mezcal and tequila are different from pulque in that they are distilled spirits. And in the region of tequila, agaves are called mezcals, and the high alcohol product of their distillation is called mezcal. Tequila is made from agave, tequiliana, commonly called blue agave. Mezcal may contain mezcal worm, which pulque and tequila do not. Agave nectar, also called agave syrup, is marketed as a natural sugar substitute with a low glycemic index that is due to its high fructose content. So that's a little bit more about agave Americana. Now, I'll also tell you a little bit about agave Americana from a personal experience. If you have one in your yard and you decide you don't want it anymore and you go in to cut it down, I did that once. It was stuffed into a hedge. It was growing all poorly, and it's a wonderful plant, but in the wrong spot. So I decided I had to remove it. So I went in and started cutting off the leaves. Well, within minutes, I had developed a rash all over my body, and it was from just the volatile organics coming off the cut surface. It only took about 5 minutes for that to start. But very quickly, I had red blotches all over my upper chest, and I was itching like crazy. So I had to stop after cutting on the leaves for about 15 minutes. I was cutting the leaves and just putting them in a trash can. I didn't get any of the juice on me at all. And then I went and stood in the shower for a good 30 minutes, just cold water, just to stop the itching. The red patches persisted for several days, but the itching went away. And then other people told me, oh yeah, that's really common. When you start to remove an agave Americana, if it's still alive with green leaves, it will cause a rash on you. Now, maybe some people don't get it, but it's actually well known. Now, the next one we want to look at is agave attenuata. And agave attenuata is very, very commonly grown in Southern California and does really well here. A little tender, and cold winters, you'll get some frost damage to it. It's known as lion's tail or swan's neck or fox tail, because of the way it flowers, and you'll see that in a moment, because the flower has a curved stem, usually unusual among agaves. Agaves usually have very vertical or straight flowers, and you can see that behind me. Bring this up full screen. Here's a big clump of agave attenuata, and here are the flower stalks. They cascade like this, and often you'll see a big clump of these like this, and they'll be doing it all over. It's really quite spectacular. Then the main rosette where this came from will die back, but this one sends up pups or suckers off the main stem, and that's why you get these huge clumps quite frequently. And this is at the Huntington Botanical Gardens. It is native to the plateau of central Mexico as one of the unarmed agaves. This agave does not have sharp tips on the leaves. So if you bump up against it, it won't poke you through your pants and into your skin. The stems typically range from 20 to 60 inches in length, and eventually old leaves fall off. The leaves are ovate accumulate, or acuminate, 20 to 28 inches long and 5 to 6 inches wide. Pale in color, ranging from light gray to light yellowish green. There are no teeth on the edges of the leaves. and there's no terminal spine. They do come to a terminal point, but it's not sharp and hard. And they have greenish yellow flowers in these large cascading panicles. The original specimens were sent to Kew by explorer Galeotti in 1834 from an unspecified location in central Mexico. So it's also found in Jalisco, east to Mexico, in small colonies at elevations to 19 to 2,500 meters. But there have been few sightings suggesting this agave is rare in the wild. Now, our next agave is one of my favorites. It's really pretty. It's agave Victoria Reginae. And let's bring this up, bring it up full screen, because it's just a really, really pretty agave. It has very, very sharp spines at the tips, very hard. And you can kind of see them here in the photograph poking up. So very typical of agaves. This is Queen Victoria's agave. That's why it's called Victoria Reginae. It's a small species of agave, noted for its streaks of white on sculptured geometrical leaves and popular as an ornamental. It is named for Queen Victoria, kind of obvious. This agave is hardly variable in form, but in general, the rosettes are small and compact, composed of short, rigid, thick leaves that are green with a pattern of distinctive white markings. The markings are generally along the leaf keels or margins, giving a sort of polyhedral appearance. Marginal teeth are usually lacking, while the terminus of the leaf may include 1 to 3 spines. There are a handful of subspecies. You can find various clones of this one and hybrids. But this is a really pretty one. I used to have a really nice one that unfortunately disappeared off my front porch. And I keep going looking for an inexpensive one somewhere, and I haven't found a really inexpensive one yet. Let's take a look at our next agave, which is agave Sawiai, and bring that up full screen. And here's a rather typical agave. This one is obviously toothed on the margins with a very sharp tip at the end of the leaves. Now, of course, the leaves themselves will be flexible. You can bend them without breaking them. Actually, yes, that's what I want. Yes, they are. They're flexible. This is found only along the Pacific coast of Baja California, extending north into the coastal chaparral of southernmost California. So this one is a true Southern California native. So for those of you who want to grow California natives, and you grow redwood trees, I suggest you switch to this. This is really native to Southern California. It is small to medium agave with green ovate leaves, 20 to 50 centimeters long and 8 to 20 centimeters wide, and varial patterns of marginal teeth. Inflorescence forms a panicle 2 to 4 meters in height, so that could be as much as 12 feet tall. And large purple bracts, so that's a little different. Usually they have white or yellowish white flowers. But they do have yellowish or reddish flowers. In general, flowers February to May, and as typical for agaves, the rosette dies thereafter. Although capable of reproducing by suckering, populations vary considerable in this behavior, with some consisting entirely of individual rosettes, while others form groups or colonies of clones. So, you know, even though many do, many of the agaves will continue pupping off the base, not all of them do, and so you should be aware of that. Our next one is agave Palmerii, and this is a really nice one. Bring it up full screen. And you can see, again, another typical agave, but making a very large clump, and it's got this blue color to it. So it's native to Arizona. It leaves 3.5 feet, flower stalks to 20 feet. Six segmented flowers are clustered atop towering flower stalks and have yellowish or reddish anther filaments and the scent of overripe fruit. The plants die after flowering and setting seed. The leaves are in usually solitary, non-suckering basal rosettes, bluish to greenish gray in color, lanceolate edged with reddish, recurved spine-like teeth and tipped with long, stout, dangerously sharp spines. Stabs with agave leaves can be quite painful and bloody. They are a good, a lot of these agaves are actually very good attractors for nectar-loving birds, orioles, bats, I don't know if they're red, they'll probably, you know, I think the aloes probably are better attractors for hummingbirds. This is the largest native agave in the United States. The leaves have been used for fiber for hunting nets, baskets, rope, and sandals. The lifespan is anywhere from 5 to 25 years, not 100 years, even though it is a century plant. Flowers during its last year produces pups for propagation. Flower stalk can be up to 18 feet high, and the stalks can grow up to 1 foot per day, easily grown by pups or seed. Sharp spines, and there is a danger that this particular agave is being over-collected in the wild for bootleg mezcal industry in northern Mexico and reduced populations in southeast Arizona due to development. Of course, mezcal is a Spanish name for agave, and mezcal pits date back to at least 8,000 years. A waxy coating with a powdery surface seals the leaf against evaporation. That's really true of almost all agaves. And it can reflect up to 75% of the incoming heat. Now, it says this particular agave has CAM photosynthesis. That's crassula acid metabolism. That's a unique way to conduct photosynthesis in plants that are growing in deserts. So it was originally named after the genus Crassula, but it's been found in many of these desert plants. It allows them actually to get their carbon dioxide at night and close up during the day. And it saves them a lot of water. Let's see. So that's agave palmarii, and that's a really nice one. Our next one is agave perii, another century plant type, but really spectacular. Let's bring this up full screen. This one is just really spectacular. I've got to get more of these in my own garden, to tell you the truth. Look at that. And now, this is important. You see all these plants along the edge? Very similar looking, but those are aloes. This is agave. These are aloes. And you can grow them right next to each other because they have the same requirements. And that's really important, too, when you're trying to develop your garden. You want to have plants with the same water needs in the same area and not be growing something that needs a lot of water next to something that needs no water. So you can't grow your fuchsias next to your cactus. Or you can't grow your fruit trees in a lawn because lawns need frequent shallow irrigation and fruit trees need infrequent deep irrigation. So perii, known as Perry's agave or mezcal agave, slow-growing agave native to Arizona, New Mexico, and northern Mexico. The leaves are gray-green and have a spine at the tip. One of the distinguishing features is that the point of the tip, which is typically dark tan, brown, or black, is darker than the leaf. Indentations of previous leaves show on the back of each leaf. Because of its compact size, plus its low water use and low maintenance, this agave is considered a good landscaping plant for desert regional landscaping. You'll see this a lot in Arizona, especially around Phoenix and Tucson. Requires full sun, hardy to roughly minus 5 degrees Fahrenheit. So this would be an excellent species to grow up against our low mountains. Though there are reports of specimens surviving temperatures at minus 20 degrees Fahrenheit. Evergreen, of course, produces a 12-foot flowering spike with bright yellow blooms. They die after blooming, as all leaf and root resources are put into the stalk, flowers, and seeds, propagated either by offset or seed. And now probably one of the agaves most dear to my heart, agave tequiliana. And let's take a look at this one, agave tequiliana. It looks quite different than the ones we just saw. Commonly called blue agave, it is very blue. Bring it up full screen, get a better look at it. Also called the tequila agave. It is an important economic product of Jalisco, Mexico, due to its role as a base ingredient of tequila, a popular distilled spirit. The high production of sugars, mostly in the form of fructose, in the core of this plant is the most important characteristic of the plant, making it suitable for preparation of alcoholic beverages. Native of Jalisco, Mexico, the plant favors high altitudes of more than 1,500 meters. Boy, that's about 4,000 to 5,000 feet. That's pretty high up. Grows in rich, sandy soils. While commercial and wild agaves have different life cycles, both grow into large succulents with spiky, fleshy leaves that can reach over 2 meters in height. Agaves sprout a stalk when about 5 years old that can grow an additional 5 meters and are topped with yellow flowers. The stalk is cut off from commercial plants, so the plant will put more energy into the heart. It is pollinated by bats and produce several thousand seeds per plant, then the plant dies. The shoots on commercial plants are removed when about a year old to allow the heart to grow larger. The plants are then reproduced by planting these shoots. This has led to considerable loss of genetic diversity. It is rare for one kept as a houseplant to flower, but a 50-year-old blue agave in Boston grew 10-meter stalk requiring a hole in the greenhouse roof and flowered in the summer of 2006. They will flower if you put them out in your garden and grow them into full size, but it may take 10, 20 years for it to bloom. You actually make the tequila by removing the heart of the plant in its 12th year. Harvested hearts are normally weigh between 80 to 200 pounds. This heart is stripped of its leaves and heated to remove the sap, which is fermented and distilled. As far as diseases, as agave production has moved to an industrial scale since the end of the 1980s, diseases and pests have proliferated. That's not unusual. You'll go out into the wild and you'll find wild plants and you can't find any problems on them. That's because they're spaced far apart. There's no introduced exotic pests to begin with. But once you put them all into rows and start growing them like a farm, boom, you find out that there are diseases that affect them. It's happened many times. There is a fusarium problem on them and an awenia problem. Awenia is a bacteria, and that's probably a rot, especially if you puncture the leaf or puncture the plant and the awenia gets in there, it will cause a soft rot. And you also have an agave weevil. Now, the agave weevil has become a big, big problem. And I know some growers who have said they're going to stop growing agaves because the weevil has become such a big problem for them to control. This weevil gets in deep into the heart of the plant. It'll go to a lot of different agave species, and there's just no good controls. I'm not sure if imidacloprid as a systemic drench would work or not. I'd probably need to talk a little bit more to some of the people who are taking care of them. And they have some other pathogens that are important as well. Now, agave angustifolia is our last agave that we're going to look at. Let's take a look at that one. It is native to Mexico and Central America. It is used to make mezcal and also as an ornamental plant, especially the marginata variety. And bring this up full screen. This is the marginata variety. And you can see it's called marginata because the edge of the leaves are white. So it's a variegated form. See these white edges here. So some sources maintain them as distinct species with non-overlapping native distributions. Has a narrow, stiffly erect leaves with moderately spaced spines producing capsules. And there's another agave viviparo, which is very similar. And the question has been for a long time whether these are the same species or different species. But this is a very, very pretty one with these very narrow leaves. So you can have a really striking garden using a variety of these agaves. Now, usually you want to have them back up against the house and then you can have lower stuff in front. So if you're going to rip out your lawn and you want to go with something really pretty, these agaves are spectacular. And around them, you want to put some type of mulching material, either rock or gravel or, maybe pumice or some kind of stone, and that'll suppress the weeds. One of the biggest challenges when you're trying to get a new drought-tolerant garden established is suppressing the weed growth, because you're going to have a lot of bare ground around a lot of these plants. Now, you can grow some ice plants or maybe some other very, very drought-tolerant ground covers in around them. Ice plants, Diamondia, maybe sedums, some crassulas. These are all succulent-type plants that'll do quite well. Diamondia is not really a succulent, but it's a low-growing, very drought-tolerant ground cover. Now, I have a video on agaves, and I want to go to this video, and we're going to see some of the same agaves I saw, but, this is your chance maybe to get a notepad and a pencil or pen and jot down some of these names and go look for them in the nurseries. I'll tell you, these type of plants, if you get large specimens, are fairly expensive. So, generally speaking, you're going to want to get smaller ones in 1 gallon pots or 4-inch pots if you want to save a little money, and then be patient and let them grow. They don't grow real fast, but they do grow. Let's take a look at this video, and then we'll talk more about agaves when we get back.
Agaves are native to the southwest in Mexico. Depending on the variety, leaves may be several inches to several feet long. Agaves have crisp silhouettes that look great in front of boulders and walls. Large agaves make excellent garden focal points. Diminutive agaves are ideal for pots and for massing in garden beds. Agave attenuata, or foxtail agave, is a soft, smooth-leaved agave that doesn't have the teeth and the sharp terminal spines of many agaves. It is a great plant for Southern California, especially along the coast. This is a very frost-tender succulent. Inland, where temperatures may drop below 32 degrees in the wintertime, is not the best place for these agaves right out in the open, unless you grow them as understory plants, where they will be protected by overhanging branches. And here you see Agave Ferdinand Regis. I don't know why this agave isn't used more often in landscapes, because it's just stunning, very easy to grow. It is related to Agave Victoria Reginae, but it actually gets bigger. This is Agave Vilmariniana. The common name is octopus agave, but it will get to 5 or 6 feet tall and about that in diameter. This is one of my favorites. It's Agave Blue Glow, and it only gets to about 18 inches in diameter over time. You can see how the leaf margins glow when they're backlit. This is Agave Perii Truncata, just a wonderful artichoke of a plant. Agave Bracteosa has this star-shaped growth pattern. The new leaves come out and create what looks like a star. Agave Americana is one of the largest of the agaves and of all succulents. It can get by in very poor soil, decomposed granite, clay, sandy soils. It doesn't care. It loves it if you'll pamper it and give it lots of water, but it will get by on rainfall alone. In Southern California, we get about 12 to 15 inches of rain a year. That's all this plant needs. If you do plant it and irrigate it, it will grow faster, be lush and prolific, and it will pop, meaning up from its roots will sprout new little plants. Teeth along the leaf margins pressed into the flesh of the inner leaf, creating these indentations. Agave Americana marginata is gray-blue along the center of the leaves and has yellow along the leaf margins. Like its cousin, Agave Americana, it gets to be really big over time. Agave Americana, Mediopicta alba, or the tuxedo agave, is also one of the smaller of the Agave Americanas, only getting to about 3 or 4 feet in diameter and 2 or 3 feet tall. Agave Franzosini grows to be one of the largest of the agaves. This is actually a small one. It is about half the size that the plant will be when it gets bigger. This one is about 3 feet tall by 3 feet in diameter. Agave Francescini has this wonderful blue silver color. Almost looks like tin foil. It's so silvery. The one downside to agaves is that they're monocarpic, meaning they bloom once and then die. So when you see an agave with a bloom spike, you know that that plant is toast.
A nice little clip, and it showed you, you know, a number of agaves I didn't mention. Like I said, there's about 200 species. So they're really fun. They look spectacular in your garden. You can disappear for months, go on vacation all summer, come back at the end of the summer, and they don't look any different than the day you left, even though nobody watered them. So that's the kind of thing that'll set you free. You don't have to have an automated sprinkler system. You don't have to have somebody show up and mow your lawn once a week. You'll reduce your water use dramatically, and you can water them once a month and they'll actually do quite well, or you can water them every other month and they'll do pretty good still. So really, really drought tolerant, and actually some natives that are truly native to Southern California, and in a way, even if they're native to Arizona, that's close enough. I'll call it a native still. So let's talk about, let's talk about aloes. Now, aloes are very similar to agaves, but there's some really important differences. One, they're not native to the Americas. They're native to Africa. They have completely different flowers. They don't have sharp tips on the ends of their leaves, so they don't poke through your pant leg and poke a hole in you. And that actually, I think there's something on the agave tips that burns and stings. And so that's quite common, that when you get poked, it really hurts and can burn for a while. And instead of the leaves being flexible and soft with kind of a fibrous leaf, they have a brittle leaf that snaps. And let me see if I've got, you know, a handful of different kinds of aloes here. Here's one right here. And I'm going to do this on a lower leaf. And I'm just going to, hopefully it'll work for me. I'm going to bend it. And it doesn't want to break. It's supposed to break. Wouldn't you know it? Probably that one's an older leaf and it's drying out. But yeah, there it goes. You see, that broke. Now, the other thing is when they break, they're filled with this gel. Probably a lot of people have heard about aloe vera. And of course, when you break an aloe vera leaf, it'll do the same thing as this. You see, I broke this leaf right here. It just snapped right off. You bend it and it's brittle, it breaks. The tip is not a sharp spine right here. That's not sharp. It doesn't poke me. There are teeth along the edge, and they're pretty stiff, and they can scratch you. So it'll do that. Now, this one particular aloe is called Aloe California. It also has some other names, and it's a hybrid. And we're going to take a break here in a minute. But before, let's talk about a few of these. This is Aloe California, Aloe Hybrid. Of course, drought tolerant when established. Aloe California forms tallish, loose rosettes of lanceolate bluish-green leaves with translucent green teeth along the margins and white oval spots on the leaf surfaces. Excellent for borders, rock gardens, as patio plants, protect from frost, provide bright light and sun. These are pretty much full sun. Hardy to 36 degrees. Water thoroughly when soil is dry. So now if I leave this here, it'll probably just tip over. So I'm going to set it down. But that's an Aloe California. I have a second one too. And I might as well pull it over here. We'll get into a lot of these species here in a minute, but I just want to show you some of the ones I dragged up with me. I actually bought this one today at Home Depot. It was $13. Aloe California needs well-drained soil, water thoroughly when soil is dry to the touch. I would say rarely water. Water once a month max. You can see it's got white spots on the leaves. It's got these white teeth. This one's a little more flexible, but I'll tell you, if you're working on these, they can scratch you a little bit. But the tips are not sharp. You see these tips? And if I bend one of these, it's going to break. I don't want to keep breaking the leaves because you saw that I already broke one. And it's got this gooey gel inside. And a lot of aloes have been used medicinally, particularly aloe vera, but not all of them. I'm just reading an email to me here on the TV screen below. But anyway, so I purchased this one today at Home Depot. You know, I've often stopped at various nurseries. I'm a real nursery nut. Probably the worst place for me to go is a nursery with my credit card in hand. They didn't have much of a selection. In the past years, I'll stop by and they'll have lots of 4-inch or 3-inch, various aloes and agaves. And they do have a handful of cactus like that. And that's nice. But not a very wide selection today, at least. And I know their selection varies from week to week because they get things out and they sell them all and they get more stuff in. You know, I don't want to be hypercritical. I just was disappointed today that there wasn't a better selection. And I couldn't really find any agaves, by the way. I couldn't find any agaves at Home Depot today. So there are some really excellent nurseries. There's one out in Reseda, and I'm trying to remember the name of the nursery now. Really excellent, a nursery for succulents, cactus, aloes, agaves. But another one is the California Cactus Center on Rosemead in Pasadena. They have a really excellent collection of lots of species, a lot of big plants that are very expensive, by the way. But they have small stuff too, and not exorbitantly expensive. 4-inch pots and 3-inch pots. You can expect to pay maybe $10 for a 4-inch pot of various aloes and agaves. So they're not cheap, cheap plants, but they're easily grown. And unfortunately, mine sometimes grow legs and walk away from my house. So these two are actually the same. This is Aloe California. And I was reading about it here on the internet. Oh, actually, this is a different one that I bought. Now, let me bring up one of my favorite aloes. I'll show you real quick before we take our break. This one is really unique. This one is called Aloe plicatalis. It is the only aloe that the leaves are opposite. If you see, here's the stem, and the leaves come off opposite. This one I've had for quite a few years now, and it's actually branching and creating two heads. I'm going to spin it around to the backside, and you can see it's got a head here, it's branching. And then on the other side, it's got another branch right in here. So this stem is coming up and branching. Here are some old leaves that have dried up. Unfortunately, it tipped over on me this morning when I was loading it in my truck and I bent the leaves, which is really disheartening because this is one of my prized aloes that I have at home. So this is Aloe plicatalis. Now, the other really important thing about aloes is they don't die after they bloom. So if you plant something like this in your garden, and this will become 4 to 5 feet tall, or maybe even taller, but the biggest one I've ever seen is at the Los Angeles County Arboretum. And it's got a pretty good sized trunk, and it comes up and it branches, and it's got all these leaves that are opposite. Really neat, Aloe plicatalis. So this is one of my favorite aloes, and I've had that one for quite a few years. And now a lot of aloes are actually trees, and a lot of aloes are small, kind of maybe only 12 inches off the ground. And of course they grow typically as rosettes. And that's why I wanted to show you that plicatalis, because it doesn't grow as a rosette. This is another aloe I brought in today. It's got a bunch of various things accumulated in the leaves. And it's got some very stiff spines on it. Let's take a look at this one. Maybe we can get a close up on this before we take our break. This is a really pretty one. And you can see the rosette form. You see, this is called a rosette when all the leaves come off as a whorl from the stem. This is Aloe Mini Bell. It's a hybrid, and it'll probably say that this is a hybrid from Ed Hummel, hybrid named after his wife, Mini Bell. Now, Ed Hummel is a well-known hybridizer of aloes. Small rosette with attractive spikes, bell-shaped vermilion flowers, excellent for windowsill culture, dish gardens, and rock gardens. Of course, porous soil with adequate drainage, protect from frost. Hardy to 36 degrees Fahrenheit, water thoroughly when soil is dry. This is the kind of thing, again, all of these plants that we're going to look at today are incredibly drought tolerant, and you can ignore them for months. Now, they do better with regular monthly irrigation, or maybe in the heat of the summer, maybe every 2 weeks. Now, we're going to take a little break here, and when we come back, we're going to talk about aloes, and maybe we'll talk a little bit about yuccas. I'll throw those in too. another good group for Southern California. So when we come back, we'll talk more about plants. See you then.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
I'm Timothy Hudson, member of the Drug and Alcohol Counselor Program faculty at California State University, Dominguez Hills. Abuse of tobacco, alcohol, and illicit drugs is costly to our nation, exacting over $600 billion annually in costs related to crime, lost work productivity, and health care. What's often not talked about is the emotional and mental costs that people abusing substances do to themselves and those around them. I'd like to invite you to join us for a series of live interactive discussions about addiction in America, what it looks like, how it can be successfully treated, and how you can pursue a career in counseling. Join us each week for information, encouragement, and solutions that can change the future for you and those around you. We look forward to seeing you.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
Hello, my name is Maria Rosales. I'm a senior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm majoring in Criminal Justice Administration. The reason why I decided to come to this campus was for its great faculty, great location, and friendly environment.
Hello, my name is Lira Harding. I'm a junior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. The reason why I chose this university was for small classes and interactive programs.
Tune in to DHTV on Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. for Jazz in the Modern Era with Chet Hanley, the only live interactive jazz program on cable television in Southern California. If you like jazz, you'll love Jazz in the Modern Era.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills. Yeah.
Welcome back to Gardens of California. My name is Gerald Turney, and I'm your host and instructor. And this is the live garden show broadcast, where you can call in and ask questions about your garden, or you can email us questions about your garden. Today, we're talking about aloes and agaves. We've kind of covered the agaves in the first hour. We've talked a little bit about the aloes. But if you have a question about your garden, give us a call. Our number is 800-339-1193. If you had a problem in your garden, your fruit trees didn't do so good, you've got leaf spots, or if you're just interested in a certain plant material, want to know if it'll do well in California or in Southern California, give us a call. Now, our mystery object today is right here. It's kind of small, but kind of is an entry to a large discussion about what causes this on pine branches. So maybe do a close-up and see if you can show it. There it is. So I'll give you another little clue that when it matures, this outer covering will come off and it'll be covered with yellow powder. If I tell you too much more, it'll almost give it away. But this is our mystery object. Give us a call if you think you know what it is. This occurs on pine trees and it's fairly common throughout the western United States. So let's talk a little bit more about aloes. We were looking at aloes. This is the last one we looked at. This is a hybrid, really pretty little guy called Aloe Mini Belle or Bella. So that's real nice, nice rosette. So that's one I've had for quite a long time. I need to move it up into a bigger pot. And we talked about this one. This was Aloe California. It's kind of a bluish aloe. It's another hybrid. And then let me reach over here and drag this one over. I'm going to go ahead and set this one out of the way so I can get this one over here. Here it comes. Another one that I picked up at Home Depot this morning. And I'm not doing an ad for Home Depot. There's one close to my house. And I was hoping they'd have a little bit better selection, but they have these two, so I picked them up. This one was also $13. This is called Aloe Candy Corn. It's a hybrid between Aloe Vatosanda and Aloe Divaricata. So this is a hybrid called Candy Corn. There's another one that I found on the internet called Ranch Fire. Fire Ranch. That has the same parentage. And people on the internet are asking, is it the same plant or is it a different plant? And the difference would be that the teeth on candy corn are white and the teeth on fire ranch are supposed to be red. And then people are asking, is that an environmentally induced or is it the same? Now, I think you've got two different hybrids. When you hybridize two plants together and you get a bunch of seed, you're not going to get uniform plants. They're going to be a little bit different. So if you propagate it from cuttings or from, then you'll get clones. But that's candy corn. This is, of course, it's another aloe. It doesn't have the sharp tip like the agaves, but it's toothed and it'll scratch you up when you're working on it. So you should wear a long sleeve shirt or you should wear long gloves that cover your arms. Now we have a question here. It says I think this is Michelle or Michael, Michelle. There are all these ads on TV and radio about tearing up your lawn and replacing it with something else. What is better, artificial turf or indigenous low-water plants? Well, you're asking a botanist who has a rather intrinsic hate of artificial turf. I think you're always better growing low-water use plants or any kind of plant material. I'm glad you asked this in a way because you don't have to dig up your old lawn to get rid of it. Now, of course, you could spray it with Roundup and kill it, or even easier than that, even cheaper really, is to cover it with cardboard and then put 4 inches of compost on top of the cardboard, and that will absolutely kill your lawn. Then you just wait a while, a few months, the lawn dies. Now you can dig holes wherever you want and put in agaves, aloes. We haven't talked much about euphorbia, but euphorbias are also from Africa. They look a lot like cactus. It's a big genus, lots and lots of species within euphorbia. You can use ground covers. You can use ice plants like Lampranthus or Carpobotus. I'm not a big fan of Carpobotus. It's the big thick-leaved ice plant with the big flowers, but they're kind of scattered flowers, not a whole lot of them. I like the Lampranthus with the smaller leaves, the smaller flowers, and the fluorescent flowers. And it's a carpet of flowers when they bloom. Really spectacular. So you can use that for your ground covers. You can use Crassula, which is another favorite genus. There's Crassula, there's Sedum. There's all these succulents that you can use as the ground covers. There's a whole bunch of species of Sedum. I mean, it's just a huge genus. And so then you use that at, you know, along the edges of the sidewalks or your pathways. You can put in some boulders. You can put in Agave Americanas farther back up against the house. You know, I'm not really a designer, but no, I would absolutely use plant material. And to tell you the truth, the people who have told me the prices they're paying to put in artificial turf, it's expensive. And I think it's cheaper to put in plant material, especially if you put in small plants and let them grow. You don't have to have a finished landscape when you first install it. It's you're planting a new landscape, put in little plants and let them grow. Now, if you're doing a sedum ground cover, you're gonna put them every three, you know, you're gonna put a small, maybe what they call rose pots, which are like 1 inch by 1 inch or 2 inch by 2 inch. And, or if you get it in a flat, you can, you know, take the plants out and put them every 3 inches or every 6 inches, and then put down some compost to suppress the weeds and let them grow and fill in, and they will. You don't have to, it's not like when you put in a new lawn and you put it in you roll out a new lawn from sod and boom, you have an instant green lawn. So don't expect that. You have to go in with the expectation that it's going to take time for your new landscape to fill in and reach its full potential. It's not overnight. So put it in. If you want to keep the cost down, go with smaller plants, a little farther spacing apart. It's less installation, less work to install it because you're putting in fewer plants. You can spend money because you're buying fewer plants. The big problem with these converting is keeping the weeds out. And that's always a challenge, especially because you're going to get Bermuda grass coming up and it's really invasive, grows all over the place, or St. Augustine's going to come in all over the place. So some people would prefer to start by killing the lawn with an herbicide like Roundup. You don't have to do that if you don't want to use that. You can use cardboard and mulch. And I've seen people, quote the cost of an artificial turf, $10,000 to put in a fairly large piece of artificial turf. And then, you would be surprised how hot it gets. When you, in the middle of the summer, you go walk out on an artificial turf, and if, in Southern California, in a hot inland valley, the San Gabriel Valley, the San Fernando Valley, and that artificial turf's out in the full sun, and you walk on it, and it's hot. It's as hot as pavement, walking on an asphalt pavement, which can be over 100 degrees, Who knows how hot asphalt pavement actually gets? Very hot. So lawns stay cool because they're, giving off, water's passing through the plant, evaporating out, and that cools the plant. Artificial turf doesn't do that. It gets very hot. And that's actually been a concern for some of the sports fields they've converted over to artificial turf, that during the middle of the day, that turf is very, very hot. And it will actually, if you're out there walking around on it, that heat passes into your shoes and into your feet, and your feet get hot. So, no, I don't like artificial turf. I'm not a big fan of it. It has its place. It's okay. It's just not what I would use in my own garden because I like plants. That's why I became a botanist. So let's talk about some more plants that you can put in your garden instead of artificial turf. Let's talk about aloe some more. Aloe, we talked about this genus. There are about 500 species. They are most common and well-known. The most common and well-known is aloe vera, the true aloe, but that's not what you see behind me. Behind me you see aloe striata, which is a really pretty little aloe. Let's see. The genus is native to Africa, and that's important because this is an example of convergent evolution where plants in African deserts have developed this morphological characteristic of having thick, fleshy leaves in a rosette and growing very slowly compared to agaves that you find in Mexico and Central America and in Southern United States in desert climates. And so What else about it? Common in South Africa, Cape Province, the mountains of tropical Africa and neighboring areas of Madagascar, the Arabian Peninsula, and the islands off of Africa. They are currently considered to be in the family Xanthothoraceae, and they've been bounced around a lot. Aloes have been bounced around a lot. They used to be, they have their own family, the Aloaceae. And before that, they were in the lily family, the Liliaceae. But who cares what family they're in? They're nice plants and they're easy to grow. They're not hard to grow. They don't have a lot of pest problems right now. None that I can think of. Agaves are threatened by the agave weevil. There is one problem on aloes, and we'll talk about that too. So most aloe species have a rosette of large, thick, fleshy leaves. The leaves are often lance-shaped with a sharp apex and spiny margin. Aloe flowers are tubular, frequently yellow, orange, pink, or red, and we'll see those flowers in a minute. Born in densely clustered and pendant at the apex of simple or branched leafless stems. Many species appear stemless because it'll look like, and this is very similar to agaves, it looks like the leaves are growing right out of the soil. But others become actually trees. Here's a big distinction between agaves and aloes. In the aloe genus, there are tree species that get to 20 to 30, even 40 feet in height with large trunks. You don't see that at all in agaves. There are no agave trees that I'm aware of. Somebody can call me up and tell me a species, I'll look it up. But I know no agaves that become trees. Aloes have been historically used for a variety of reasons by humans in Africa. They've used for medicinal uses, primarily. Of the 500 species of aloe, only a few were used traditionally as herbal medicine, aloe vera being the principal species. Also included are aloe perii from northeastern Africa and aloe ferox found in South Africa. The Greeks and the Romans used aloe vera to treat wounds. In the Middle Ages, the yellowish liquid found inside the leaves was favored as a purgative, and I don't need to tell you what that means. Unprocessed aloe that contains aloin is generally used as a laxative, whereas processed aloe vera juice does not usually contain significant amounts of aloin. Now, some species, particularly aloe vera, are used as alternative medicine as a home first aid. And I've used it. I have a large aloe vera in my front yard, and when I burn myself occasionally, I'll break off a leaf and I'll rub that gel or that, you know, that thick mucilage onto the burn area, and it stops it from burning. It alleviates the pain. I don't know that it causes to heal faster. That's kind of a disputed characteristic, but I like to think it does. Maybe it does or doesn't. But it certainly makes it feel better right away. Aloe vera juice is commonly used internally to relieve digestive discomfort. Some modern research suggests aloe vera can significantly slow wound healing. So some of the research tends to tell you that it's not the best thing for you in terms of what to put on for a burn, but I still use it today. I don't want to go too much into that. We'll talk about the species now, but I have a phone call. So let's go to our first caller. Terry calling from Pasadena. You're on the air. Now I need to move this out of the way. Okay, go ahead, Terry.
I have a question about growing aloes. I have about a 12-inch high aloes, and some of them have this strange growth on them.
Oh, okay.
And it looks like a brain is in the center of the plant.
Okay, that's a pretty apt description of what I think you've got. There are a handful of aloe species, usually the lower growing ones that only get to about 12 inches in height, are susceptible to a mite called the aloe mite. And it is a mite that causes a gall. And so what you see there is a result of the mite feeding on the leaves, and then this gall forms. There's no good treatment for it. If you have that, you should tear them out and throw them in the trash. Because the mites will reproduce in those galls, and they'll spread to more of your aloes. It's a big problem. I see it on aloe arborescens. I see it on aloe striata and on their hybrids. I'm not sure of the host range for the mite. It may go to a few others. I've never seen it on any of the tree aloes, so they probably don't get it. but it does affect a lot of the aloes that grow very low to the ground and, you know, only get about ankle to shin height for the mature height. People have tried a lot of different chemical treatments, various insecticides. It is a mite, so you'd have to use a miticide specifically, but some of the insecticides also control mites quite well. Some of the insecticides that probably aren't on the market anymore would have worked best. I know that diazinon used to work really well for very similar mite on fuchsia, called the fuchsia gall mite. These are called areophytid mites, and they're very strange little mites. Often, at one stage in their life cycle, they only have four legs instead of eight legs that mites are supposed to have, because mites are related to spiders and ticks. They have eight legs. They're not insects. They're arachnids. But so that's the aloe mite. It causes a strange gall, and I actually have some pictures I'll show you later in the broadcast of the aloe mite galls. Unfortunately, what you really need to do is just dig them up and throw them in the trash.
Oh, okay, that's too bad.
Yeah.
Well, thank you for answering that.
Yeah, you know, hopefully it won't spread to the rest of them. Okay, thank you for calling.
Oh, it's not. Okay, thanks.
Yeah, the aloe mite's a big problem on a handful of aloes, and we'll see that aloe mite here in a minute. Unfortunately, there's not a good chemical control for it. I probably need to, you know, touch base with a few more people, like at the Huntington and some of the succulent and cactus nurseries, and see what they're doing about it. But as far as I know, there is no real good treatment. Let's talk about our first aloe, which was Aloe striata, and bring that up full screen. Aloe striata is the coral aloe. This is to about 18 inches tall by 2 feet wide, with rosettes of a few flat, broad, pale green leaves that vary in color depending on the amount of sunlight they get. In hot, full sun, the foliage is pinkish, and in shadier spots, they are often bluish green. Leaves have notable dark, narrow lines running longitudinally, and toothless. So if you bring that back up, I want to show you something. Most aloes have teeth along the edges. If you really get aloe striata, the species striata, the edge is smooth. There's no teeth on it. Now, a lot of the ones at the Arboretum, when I worked there, we labeled aloe striata, but they had little teeth right along here, you know? And so we knew it was a hybrid. It wasn't a true species. In late winter to early spring, you will get three 2 foot tall stems that branch and hold clusters of coral red flowers. And I think I don't have any pictures of aloe striata flowers. This plant is often sold as a solitary plant, but will slowly produce new rosettes at the base to form a cluster. Plant in full sun to light shade in well-drained soil, irrigate little to regularly. Quite tolerant of dry conditions. If you should water regularly, but regularly means once a month, or maybe every other month in the spring and the fall, and maybe once a month every 2 weeks in the summer. Now that would really be dependent on where you're living. If you're down at the beach, you could probably water once a month in the summer. If you're in a hot inland valley, especially as you get farther out east, like in Palm Springs or places like that, I would water at least every 2 weeks if I were out in Palm Springs or the high desert. I would water these a little more. Certainly about every 2 weeks, but if I were in Santa Monica, I'd probably water it once a month. And somewhere in between, you know, and of course, if you take off for a few months, it'll look pretty much the same. If you water them, they're a little plumper, they're a little fuller, they look a little better. Hardy to 20 to 25 degrees, so you don't expect this one to freeze. Aloe striata is widely distributed in dry areas of eastern and western Cape provinces of South Africa, growing from 800 to 7,300 feet in elevation. Anything that naturally occurs at that high an elevation is going to have good frost resistance, or be very hardy and not freeze easily. Now, it's called striata because it is striped in allusion to the longitudinal stripes of the leaves. Beware of imposters. Much of what is sold as aloe striata in the nursery trade is actually a striata hybrid, which I mentioned before. And there is actually a subspecies, Carasbergensis, and that one is a little different, but I'm not sure the actual It's based on the lines. It's going to have a little different striations in the leaves. Now let's take a look at our next one, which is Aloe Patricula. And this is a picture. Bring this up full screen. This is a picture I took at the Los Angeles County Arboretum. And here it is in full bloom with these spectacular spikes. Now the big difference is these aren't going to die after these flowers go away. So that's the big difference between aloes and agaves. Patricula is native in South Africa. Aloe patricula belongs to the aloe genus, of course, and is commonly known as the stone aloe. A particular aloe is a flowering species with unique and distinct influences. It's easy to identify, distinguished from other aloe plants. This one has been used for medicinal purposes as it aids in healing wounds and minor burns. Plant reaches from anywhere from 18 to 24 inches in height. Now, I think these ones you see in the picture here are more like 36 inches in height. And there was great discussion about whether this particular aloe at the Los Angeles County Arboretum was correctly labeled. That's always something we like to talk about when a bunch of botanists get together. What's the real name? They can reach a little over a meter in width. Inflorescences can reach about 4 feet, surpassing the height of the plant's fleshy leaves. Virtually stemless and has rosettes of blue-green colored leaves, tightly packed flowers, dark brown anthers, and typically include two colors, usually deep red towards the top where the buds are seen, cream yellow color at the bottom towards the base, reaching the stem of the flower. So let's take a look at our next aloe. Actually, the next one is Aloe Patricula flower spikes, and I'll show you, bring that up full screen. And you can see, this is rather typical of aloes, is the top flowers are yellow and are red, and the bottom are yellow. So that's not uncommon, and sometimes it's really quite spectacular to see it that way. Now our next one is one of the tree aloes, Aloe ferox, known as the Cape aloe, is a species indigenous to South Africa's Western Cape. And you can see here that this has a long stem. This is a small tree. It's in bloom here. It's also from the Eastern Cape, Free State, and Lesotho. Aloe ferox is listed on the plant list of endangered plants. It is a CITES plant. CITES means the Convention on the Trade of Endangered Species. So if you're selling this or say a nursery in Southern California is growing these from seed and wants to ship one to some buyer somewhere outside the United States, you've got to get a certificate saying that you propagated it because it's an endangered species. They can grow to 10 feet in height, can be found on rocky hills and grassy areas and on the edges of the Karoo. The plants may differ physically from area to area due to local conditions. Its leaves are thick and fleshy, arranged in a rosette, and have reddish-bound spines on the margins with smaller spines on the upper and lower surfaces. So yeah, if you look at the leaves, they're covered with spines, not just on the edges, but all over the leaf. Flowers are orange or red and stand between 2 and 4 feet above the leaves. Our next one is Aloe rubroviolacea. And let's take a look at that next one, bring this up. And so this is not a tree aloe, obviously. This is a low-growing aloe. But you can see the leaves get this kind of a ruby glow to them. Native to the Arabian Peninsula, occurring in the mountain chain that parallels the Red Sea coast, found in both Yemen and in the adjacent part of southwestern Saudi Arabia. In nature, it grows in steep places and has a pendant or semi-pendant growth habit. Bring that back up and you'll see even when you grow them here, they don't want to grow straight up. They grow and they start tipping over so that because they're pendant. That's their natural growth habit. And the stems can sometimes creep along the ground. Now the rubroviolacea means red violet and refers to the purplish coloration taken on by the leaves in sunny settings. So if you grow this out in the full sun, you'll get this little pink or ruby glow on the leaves. Offshoots from the base arise occasionally so that in time a clump is formed. Plants flower in winter. Beginning in late November or December, there is sometimes a second flowering in summer, not nearly as many, and that's typical. A lot of times plants will have their main flowering period, and then later in the year they'll have a kind of sporadic flowering. That's not unusual at all. Flower spikes may be single or with one or two branches, dense clusters of red flowers. Although the plants themselves are quite cold tolerant, they'll tolerate down to -20 degrees Fahrenheit. The flowers can be damaged whenever freezing temperatures occur. Although this is not a problem in milder parts of California, it may cause trouble in interior locations. This next one I want to show you is another tree aloe. Well, let's take a look at the flowers for aloe rubroviolacea first and bring that in. That's our next photograph, and take a look at these flowers. These are really pretty. These plants are really pretty when they bloom. Let's take a look at our next picture, number 22. Oh, I guess we're missing that picture. So let's move on to aloe marlothii, and let's see if we have 23. Oh, here's a flower spike. Oh, that's it. That's 22. Bring that up full screen. And here, you can see this is typical tubular flowers. I think almost all of these are very good hummingbird plants. You know, the hummingbirds love the red flowers, and tubular flowers are what hummingbirds almost always go to. This one stays pretty red all the way up and down. Here, the flowers are open with the stamens and the pistils sticking out. And then these flowers up here haven't opened yet. So let's take a look at marlothii. That's our next picture, which is 23. And unfortunately, I don't have, our next picture is a good one. Let's move on to our next picture. And this shows marlothii a little better. And I don't know if you can see it, but the leaves are just covered with spines, or they're all spiky. This is known as the mountain aloe or the flat-flowered aloe. A large, single-stemmed South African aloe of rocky places and open flat country, occasionally growing as high as 20 feet tall. It ranges from Klip River Hills in Johannesburg through eastern Botswana, northwards over South Pansburg to Zimbabwe and Malawi, and eastwards through Swaziland and Mozambique to the coast. The species grades through intermediate forms into Aloe spectabilis, the two are now considered synonymous. So there is an Aloe spectabilis that I always considered a separate species, but now it's considered that Aloe marlothii and spectabilis are really the same species. This is named after Rudolf Marloth, the renowned South African botanist. In full flower presents a magnificent spectacle, the trunk densely covered by the withered old leaves, which when green can be up to 1.5 meters in length and usually densely covered in short spines on the convex lower surfaces and less so on the upper surfaces. Inflorescence is much branched panicle with up to 30 or exceptionally 50 racemes. That means branches. And you can see that, bring this picture up full screen and I'll show you what I mean. When this blooms, it's really, really spectacular. Let's bring this picture up full screen. And flowering color is through the winter months, as is the case with most aloes, forms natural hybrids with some 30 or more species. The flowers are yellow through orange to bright red. I don't know if we're having a problem bringing that up full screen. Here we go. Well, you see, each one of these is a raceme. So you can have 30 to 50 racemes. And the other thing, and I don't know if you can see it in the picture, but along the raceme, all the flowers go up like this. When you see a straight inflorescence, the flowers are on all sides, you know, on the other aloe species. But on this one, all the flowers kind of are on the top of the raceme, and you don't really see it here too good. Now, these have been cleaned off of the old leaves. So this is a really, really fun aloe, and I used to have a beautiful one, and it's another plant that I've lost off my front porch. Now, one of the places that is really famous for aloes is Ghana, is Lotus Land up in Santa Barbara. And I want to go here to this next video clip. It's our second video clip, because our show is running out of time, and I want to show you this clip. They've got a big, huge collection of aloes up there. So if you can get into this particular garden, Lotus Land. Let's take a look at this clip. They're going to show you a few other plants that are they're well known for, but they're going to look at a lot of their aloes. Let's take a look at the aloes at Lotus Land.
We're here today at Ganawaska Lotus Land in Santa Barbara, California. Virginia Hayes shows us this spectacular garden. Virginia, how did this garden become established and what's its purpose?
Well, we're here basically because Ganawaska, who created most of what you see around us, decided to grow a garden and then leave it for the rest of us to enjoy. There's an older history here. It was a nursery for a number of years in the 1880s, and then it was just a private estate. But Ganawaska owned it for over 40 years and created the gardens that we're going to see today.
You see a beautiful water feature here.
Yes, this pond was actually here in the 1920s, but Madame Walska did her particular touch to things, which was to dramatize everything and added all the shell features.
And around it, we've got plants which don't use a lot of water. We see aloes here.
That's right. This is the aloe garden.
And these aloes are from what part of the world? They're not from this part.
Most aloes are from South Africa and a few from Madagascar and other parts of Africa. Our collection is mainly from South Africa with a few Madagascans.
It's really dramatic. I like this one. It looks like a tongue.
Yes, this is called Aloe plicatilis. If you look at the way the leaves fold together, it's sort of like a braid.
Ah, okay. And then everyone's familiar with the aloe vera.
That's right.
And you've got some of that here.
We do have that, not right where we are, but the interesting thing is that most of these succulent aloes have the same medicinal properties that aloe vera is famed for.
I didn't know that.
They are not hardy, probably below 20 degrees. They may survive a few hours in the 20s, but we're essentially frost-free here.
So much of the Southwest can actually grow these then. I've seen them in Phoenix and Tucson.
Mm-hmm.
But we get into the higher desert, it's going to get too cold, so they're houseplants here.
Right.
Good medicinal houseplants, though.
That's right.
There's another tall one right there.
Yes. This is Aloe spectabilis.
That's beautiful.
And it is spectacular.
It is. They're trees.
Exactly. And they get much larger, actually, in their native habitats than they would here.
And these I like. They're nice mound formers. They're kind of nice green here.
Aloe brevifolia.
Oh, that's spectacular. And I understand you've got a world-famous garden with other plants in it here as well.
That's right. We have an amazing cycad collection.
That's something we ought to see.
Okay.
Cycad. Now, the sago palm is a cycad, but it's really not a palm, is it?
Right. It's one of the 10 or 11 genera in the cycad family that they look like palms a little bit.
A little bit. Over here we've got fan palms, but I've seen a lot of palms that look like these cycads.
Right.
And so it's easy to see that they're confused. And I say they've got cones on them.
Right. They don't have flowers. They evolved long before flowers came on the scene.
So they're more like a pine tree.
Exactly.
Than a palm.
Exactly. The interesting thing about them is that they have male cones on male plants and female cones on female plants.
Okay.
And normally where they grow, the pollination to produce seeds on those female cones would be done by little insects.
And this is really here as a scientific collection now, isn't it?
Well, it started, of course, as one of Madame's collections just for visual impact, which it certainly has.
It does.
But because she was able to get these plants so many years ago in the 60s and 70s, she was able to amass a pretty impressive collection of all the genera that grow throughout the world.
You just moved into a bunch of blue ones.
Yes. These are adapted for desert climates in Africa. And show off that blue coloration that's often seen in those kind of plants.
And over the other side is really green but tall.
Yes, a lot of these actually grow in sort of understory of a forest. Mm-hmm. And this one grew in South Africa in the forest and is now extinct in the wild. These are some of the offspring of the last plants that were removed over 100 years ago.
That's part of your scientific work then, to actually propagate these and hopefully preserve the germplasm.
Exactly. These, unfortunately, are all male. We don't have females of that species.
So you can't do, and you have to hand pollinate, don't you?
Right, right. Look at
Yes, so Lotus Land is famous for their collection of aloes, also their collection of cycads. And I've used that clip when I talk about cycads. And if you don't know what cycads are, often look like palms. They're not palms. They're cone-bearing plants. You saw that in male and female cones. But let's get back to our aloes. Our next one is Aloe arborescens. And this is kind of a clumping aloe. Let's see if we can bring up our next picture. And that's it. Bring that up. There we go. And I don't know why it's called arborescence, because it's not very arborescent, but there you go. That's the name. It's got these, you know, nice flowers. It makes a big clump, usually, you know, good 4 or 5 feet high. Let's see what it says. Arborescence, commonly known as the Krantz aloe. Relatively popular among gardens. Let's see. Multi-headed, sprawling succulent, indicating that sometimes it reaches tree size. It really doesn't. It can be a big clump, and it can be up to shoulder height for me. But it's not going to be much bigger than that. So you're looking at maybe 4 to 5 feet, and then the flowers, when it's flowering, may get up to 6 feet. They say 2 to 3 meters, which is 6 to 10 feet. Leaves are succulent green, of course. They have a very blue tint to them. Armed with small spikes. This is all common for aloes. The racemes are not branched, but two to several can sprout from each rosette. And they're red and orange, as is typical. Endemic to southeastern part of southern Africa. Includes South Africa, Malawi, Mozambique, and Zimbabwe. And on the clip, you saw that she mentioned most of the aloes there at Lotus Land are from South Africa. That's just because most of them are from South Africa. They're not, I don't think the aloes really come a lot from too much north, although we did see that some of the aloes we looked at come from Saudi Arabia. So let's take a look at Aloe aristata. And let me see, yes, that's our next one, number 26. Known as the torch plant or the lace aloe from South Africa. Stemless, sawtooth, and succulent. Commonly called cerealii, meaning slippery one, what also lace aloe or torch plant. It's often mistaken for Haworthia when not in bloom. It is one of a group called dwarf aloes. So this is a very small aloe. Extremely small rosettes of usually incurved leaves. Let's see, the leaf surfaces are marked by small white bumps, and leaf margins are armed with soft white teeth. Flowers in the month of November, and its range includes eastern and western Cape provinces of South Africa, the Orange Free State, Lesotho. Stemless and usually occur in groups of up to a dozen or so rosettes. And the next picture is it in bloom, and you can actually see how small the plant is. Bring this up full screen. This is a nice one for a pot or a little rock garden. So this isn't very big. You know, that's not a real big plant. And here's the inflorescence. Real pretty when it blooms, kind of a pink flower more than a red or an orange. But you can see, you know, this is really kind of a rock garden. You got these big rocks back here. And these make good plants for rock gardens. Now we'll take a look at our next one, which is Aloe variegata. And this is another one of my favorite aloes. I guess I have too many favorite aloes. Known as Taigo aloe from South Africa and Namibia. It grows 20 to 30 centimeters, which is about 10 to 15 inches. 18 to 24 leaves arranged in 3 ranks. So it has a really quite different growth habit than a lot of aloes. New leaves appear individually over time from the center of the plant, flattening older leaves and pushing them outward in spiral fashion. Rich green color with irregular light green banding made up of amalgamated slightly raised oval spots, slightly light colored fine serrations along each edge. Depending on trauma, space, water availability, or even old age, outer leaves will die off, turning golden brown and shriveling away. They reach maturity in 3 to 7 years, largely dependent on space, sunlight, and water availability, at which point they will begin to send out racemes of flowers. So they're not going to bloom right away until they get big enough. Flowers develop in a cluster at the head and are spaced out by its rapid growth. This aloe is found in the arid areas of Western Cape, Eastern Cape, and Northern Cape and Free State, generally in rocky terrain and outcrops where they may grow between boulders, but they may also grow in soils with sharp drainage, such as sandy soils. Aloe vera. Now, aloe vera, of course, is probably the most famous of all of them. Well, let's take a look at aloe variegated number 2 before we move on. I got a second photograph of this in bloom. Bring it up full screen, and you can see how, you know, it's not a very big plant. This is actually in a pot, and here it's starting to bloom. Not exactly the nicest garden, but a nice plant. And let's take a look at our next picture, which is aloe vera. Now, aloe vera has yellow flowers. You can see here the yellow flowers of aloe vera. Probably originated in northern Africa. Currently, there are no known naturally occurring populations in the wild, although closely related aloes do occur in northern Africa. This species is frequently cited as being used in herbal medicine since the beginning of the first century AD. So this has been around a long time. People have been using this for burns and actually drinking the juices of the plant for a long time. It's used in cosmetics, marketed variously, having rejuvenating, healing, or soothing properties. There is little scientific evidence that is true, although I've used it for burns on many occasions. It's a stemless or very short-stemmed plant growing to about 24 to 39 inches tall, spreading by offsets. The leaves are thick and fleshy, green to gray-green, with some varieties showing white flecks on the upper and lower stem. Margin of the leaf is serrated and has small white teeth. The flowers are produced in summer on a spike up to 35 inches tall, each flower being pendulous with a yellow tubular corolla. Like other aloe species, aloe vera forms arbuscular mycorrhizae. And I haven't talked to you much about arbuscular mycorrhizae, but those are fungi that infect the roots of plants and then help the plant grow. It has a lot of synonyms, barbadensis, indica, porphyrioleta, vulgaris. Common names include Chinese aloe, Indian aloe, true aloe, Barbados aloe, burn aloe, first aid plant. It's sold under a lot of names, but the interesting thing is there are no known wild populations of aloe vera, but millions of them are propagated every year around the world. It is in no danger of actually becoming extinct because it's so widely propagated. In folk medicine, aloe vera has a long association with herbal medicine. Although it is not known when its medical applications were first suspected, and there's records going back to the first century that has been used by Greeks and Romans. Now let's take a look at aloe banksii. I don't want to belabor aloe vera and banksii. Let's take a look at some more flowers of aloes of the aloe vera. Let's take a look at aloe vera 31, and this is one of the plants in bloom. Bring that up full screen. And here it is with its bright yellow flowers. So that's going to help you a lot determining that aloe vera, almost all the other aloes have orange or red flowers. And let's take a look at a close-up of aloe vera flowers. There you go. See, they're completely yellow. So that's kind of distinct for that. And now let's see here. Our pictures are out of sequence. Let me find aloe aculeata. Well, let's take a look at aloe aculeata. Let's bring this picture up. Not this picture. Okay, here we go. This is aloe aculeata. And one of the nice things about aloes is you've got the red unopened flowers and the yellow flowers at the bottom, which can be really quite striking in a landscape. This is aloe aculeata. And now let's take a look at aloe X principis. This is another aloe species. I don't really have a lot of notes on this particular species. And let's move on to a close-up of these flowers on aloe X principis and see how pretty it is. See? Now this one stays red at the base. They don't turn yellow as they open up. And now let's move on to aloe banksii. Now this one is really, really, here you go. This is a spectacular tree, and it's an aloe. So let's talk about it. It also is known as aloe barbarae. Synonym is aloe banksii. Usually you see this labeled as banksii. Known as the tree aloe, native to South Africa. Its native climes, a slow-growing tree can reach up to 54 feet in height. And 3 foot in stem diameter. Aloe banksii is Africa's largest aloe. The tree often is used as an ornament, of course. Its tubular flowers are rose pink, green tipped. It flowers in winter, and its natural environment is pollinated by sunbirds. Now, why is it, what's the real name? Well, aloe barbarae is the real name, but its banksii has been in the trade so long that you'll find nurseries probably selling as Banksii. Mary Elizabeth Barber collected this plant, and she sent specimens to the Royal Botanic Garden in 1874, and it was named in her honor that year. Subsequently, it was also found in the Natal region by a traveler and painter, Thomas Baines, and he sent plants in to Kew Gardens, and it was named after him, Aloe Banksii. But since it was named for Elizabeth Barber first, Aloe Barberdae, Barberae is the legitimate name, and the synonym is Banksii. This tree aloe's habit is subtropical coastal forests, ravines, and dry valleys in the eastern regions of southern Africa, widely distributed from Eastern Cape through the former Transkei, KwaZulu-Natal, Swaziland, northwards to Mozambique and East Africa. So it has a large distribution there. Our next one is Aloe dichotoma, and this is another big tree aloe known as the quiver tree or the corker boom, indigenous to South Africa, specifically the Northern Cape region and Namibia. The World Checklist of Selected Plant Families recognizes three subspecies, dichotoma, Pelanzii, and Ramosiama. There has also been treated as three separate species, but they're all subspecies of dichotoma. And so we've gotten a good look at a wide variety of aloes. Now, our caller earlier today mentioned that she saw stuff growing on her aloes that looked like a brain. And now let's take a look at the aloe mite damage, because I bring this up full screen. There we go. You see this growth in here? This is all a gall on this aloe caused by the aloe mite. Let's take a look at our next picture, aloe mite, our second aloe mite picture. And you can see how badly, excuse me, how badly deformed the plant is. Now you can try and just cut it out, but what you should really do is get rid of the whole plant, because this will spread to your other similar aloes. This is probably aloe arborescens, which gets it, and aloe, and a wide variety of hybrids will get it too. You'll see it on a lot of the aloes there at the Arboretum, which is unfortunate. Now, there are some very closely related, or they look very similar, and that's in the yucca genus. And I want to just talk about yuccas a little bit. It's in a different family, and there's 40 to 50 species of yucca, noted for their rosettes of evergreen, tough, sword-shaped leaves and large terminal bundles of white or whitish flowers, and probably one of the best known. Let's go to the Joshua tree yucca, because Joshua tree is really cool. Bring that up full screen. This, of course, is native. It's yucca brevifolia, and a tree-like habit reflects its common name, Joshua tree, yucca palm, tree yucca, or palm tree yucca. It is a monocotyledon tree, a native to southwestern North America in the states of California, Arizona, Utah, and Nevada, confined mostly to the Mojave Desert between 400 and 1,800 meters. It thrives in the open grasslands of Queen Valley and Lost Horse Valley and Joshua Tree National Park. There's a dense Joshua Tree forest also exists in Mojave National Preserve. Two subspecies have been described of this. They are fast growers for the desert. New seedlings may grow an average rate of 3 inches per year in the first 10 years, then only grow about 1.5 inches per year thereafter. The trunk of Joshua tree is made of thousands of small fibers and lacks annual growth rings, making it difficult to determine a tree's age. So that's the Joshua tree. The next one I want to show you is Yucca whippelii. And this is Yucca whippelii. It has a variety of common names. It's called the Spanish bayonet or Lord's candle. And this is called Lord's candle because of its flower. These are also, this particular one is monocarpic. Now the Joshua tree is not monocarpic, but Yucca whippelii is monocarpic. So as soon as it flowers, this is going to die, and it's not going to send off any pups or anything. It is native to California and Baja California. And the really interesting thing, it also is known in Mexico, of course, Baja California, Mexico. Occurs mainly in chaparral, coastal sage scrub, and oak woodland plant communities at altitudes of 300 to 2,500 meters. Stemless clusters of long, rigid leaves which end in sharp points. So a lot of times you'll see yuccas, like Yucca whippoli, you go, boy, that looks like an agave. And it's not an agave. And the tips of the leaves are just like agaves, and they'll go right through your pants and into your leg, and it burns too. Now the inflorescence, now this takes about 7 years to bloom, and the inflorescence starts coming up and will grow very fast, reaching heights of up to 18 feet, three times feet, no, about 9 feet. Well, let's take a look at this picture. I think more like 15 feet. Bearing hundreds of elliptical, bell-shaped, white to purplish flowers on a densely branched panicle covering the upper half of the inflorescence. The fruit is a dry-winged capsule. Now, the very interesting thing about this particular plant is there is a moth called the yucca moth that is the sole pollinator for this plant. And the moth comes in and lays its eggs in the flowers. The caterpillar forms in the fruit and eats the seeds, but it doesn't eat all of them, eats a bunch of them. And then the seeds, you know, one inflorescence will produce thousands and thousands of seeds. So you get lots of little plants coming up all around old dead ones. So if you go for a hike up in the San Gabriel Mountains, you'll see a lot of these old plants that have died. The inflorescence is still there. There's no flowers left. The whole thing's turned brown. But all around it, there's little seedlings coming up. Now, you need a little rain for that to happen. So let's hopefully this winter we'll get some rain. But during the spring and into the summer, you'll see these blooming on the slopes up in the San Gabriel Mountains and the Santa Monica Mountains, the San Bernardino Mountains, in the chaparral areas. It's hard to miss them because of these, you know, 10 to 15 tall, foot tall inflorescence spikes. But the really interesting thing is this relationship between the moth and the host, the yucca. It's the yucca moth and yucca whippoli. So if either one were to become extinct, the other would as well. So they are really tied to each other. This is what we call symbiosis, and it's a mutualistic relationship. They both benefit. Without the pollinator, it wouldn't make any seed. There are some subspecies of yucca whippoli. Now, the last one we want to look at is Yucca filamentosa. Now, this is one is used in the, let's see if we can get this picture up real quick. We only have a minute left. If you can bring that up behind me. This one is grown as a landscape ornamental a lot. It blooms, it looks very similar to Yucca whippoli, but it doesn't die. You get this big, huge cluster of white flowers every year, and here's these typical lance-shaped leaves. And this one's very common in landscapes. You don't see whippoli very much in landscapes. So now we've run out of time. Our show's come to an end. I want to thank everyone in the control room for their assistance in getting the show on and all their hard work. We'll be back next Sunday. And until then, I'd like to wish you happy gardening and get out and enjoy our wonderful Southern California environment.